Okay, so the upcoming presentation is about the training and education activities in Rosen. And first speaking will be Stefan Kalweit from FH Aachen.
Danke, Thilo. Thanks, Thilo. I'm just waiting for my colleague from IPA, Jonathan Hechtbauer. You see, in a couple of seconds, I think, you see that we are here at the... is it this one? Oh yeah, cool. Wait, this one. That we are working very closely together in Rosen, so that we have even just one piece of slides we are sharing. And I'm quite happy to be, let's say, part of the Rosen project. So that is Jonathan Hechtbauer, so my partner from IPA. So we are taking both care of the ROS education activities. And we will later on, I will hand over to Jonathan. Yeah, what about teaching ROS? So I hope you all remember how, perhaps how hard it was to learn ROS. I think you are all speaking ROS fluently, as I guess, but how did you learn ROS, actually? So perhaps some of you did the ROS tutorials on the ROS Wiki, some of you perhaps read books. When I learned ROS, or let's say when I was first in touch with ROS, I had before, I think, an installation. Mirko mentioned the Microsoft Robotics Studio, but that lasted just for one day, I think. Then I deleted it completely because I was a little bit fed up with it. Then I had a look at Orocos Player, so other robotic frameworks, and then I ended up with ROS, actually, with ROS Fuerte. So you see, then 2011, I started with ROS Fuerte. Then I updated quite quickly to Groovy because I liked the logo so much. And I still think the logo is quite cool, actually. Yeah, so I really liked it. So then you make a full desktop install. Of course, what else? Yeah. So you are waiting quite a lot, and then you're sitting in front of the PC, and then you think, hey, yeah. And now you sit in front, and then you click to the tutorials, and then you find something like this. During installation of ROS, you will see that you are prompted to source one of several setups, or even add this sourcing to your shell startup script. This is required because ROS relies on the notion of combining spaces. Using the shell environment, this makes developing against different versions of ROS or against different sets of packages easier. What? Yeah? So you know these WTF per seconds, right? When you are developing software. So this is not truly encouraging. When you're really a starter with ROS, you perhaps need something which supports you, which is motivating you to start with these kind of complex stuff. Of course, all the guys from the informatics departments here from the University of Applied Science, they say, yeah, come on, yeah, publisher, subscriber, it's very easy, hey. But as a mechatronic engineer, sorry, that's my background, you see, yeah, but perhaps there is a way of doing it a little bit easier. So, and when you try to do it a little bit easier, you can ask a lot of questions. So when you're teaching ROS, and that is exactly what we're doing in Rosen, we made a quite intense and detailed, just not market analysis, but we had a look in who is really the audience. So what is their background? Do they have Linux experience or not? But to be honest, we thought about, for instance, in the ROS Summer School, we thought about, okay, we only let people participate who have a little bit knowledge about Linux, but would you really kick somebody out of your course who is not perhaps able to make a setup source or whatever a source out of your bash shell script? Of course not, because we are interested in that people learn ROS, because I think that is the acceptance of ROS in industry, so that they are, let's say, in the ROS community and that they have an idea of how to program in ROS, even the smallest stuff. But so we do not kick people out who are not able, let's say, perhaps to speak Linux. The same is for some other stuff. So what are the expectations of the participants? What is their motivation? I mean, if they like to come to a training, then of course you can expect that their motivation is quite high. Perhaps even they paid money for it. And then it's quite difficult to kick them out as well. So, but perhaps one essential question is, what should they reach after they finished the training? So which level do they, at the end, have at the end, let's say, after perhaps 1 week training, or even 3 days training, or even 2 weeks training? So what is more or less the outcome of our education activities? And that leads to some other questions like the format, how many hours of theory, do you make seminars, do you make just lectures, do you make workshops and so on. And of course, finally, and that is the essential question, I think, is it still fun? Yeah? Do you really attract people and do they really still have, yeah, let's say, a kind of motivation, fun in coding, in dealing with robotics? So in Rosen, we have one guy who knows quite a lot about teaching, and that is my colleague Klaus Brabant. And he wrote a paper about the solo taxonomy, which is quite, yeah, at the let's say the first point you see, how solo, what is that? So it's not Han Solo, not the famous pilot. It's a structure of observed learning outcomes. And you see already here that it's, it looks a little bit complex, but it's actually quite easy. So let's say I would make a lecture about differential equations, and then the first thing is that you present a differential equation, so there are dots on some of the notations, and then later on you ask your students or the participant, do you see any differential equations on the breadboard? And then say, yeah, there's a dot, hey, yeah, okay, you have identified that there is a differential equation. That is solo level two. So identify, follow, or even have simple instructions, like, for instance, you teach topics, and then suddenly you have a note, a Python note, by the way, so we've switched completely to Python. That was really a nightmare to discuss it with the informatic guys, to switch to Python and not to C++. Ooh, you cannot imagine. But that is philosophy. But then you see in Solo 2, you have simple, you can identify, you can name it, and then in Solo 3, that is the combination of all the stuff you learn. So that means, you need to classify it, you need to perhaps apply methods you were taught before in a kind of tutorial, in a hands-on programming tutorial, and then you have to recombine the stuff. And then finally, you can even go up to Solo 4, which is which we do in a kind of competition way, so that you really have to recombine everything you learned in Solo 2 and Solo 3 in a way of solving unknown problems. And that is really something I think which pays off at the end, and that gave us an idea how to combine the single, let's say, parts and pieces to get people from Solo 2, or even if they started in some summer schools, they even have heard about ROS, so we call this then Solo 1. So there's something which is called ROS, but they have no really clue about what's behind, this name or the robot operating system. And so we said, okay, we can bring them in a kind of seminar, not more than 60 to 90 minutes in the morning, where we gave a little bit theoretical background, all the stuff so that they can later on identify, that's a topic, and this is perhaps a package name or something. And then we go directly into tutorials, so really hands-on programming, because we are convinced that you only learn ROS when you're really going into coding. You see here we have then hardware, three participants in one group, one robot per group, and then a lot of tutors. So we have a lot of students around who are just supporting these groups. It's called modern slavery, more or less. They get even credits for it. But you have, let's say, 20 tutors for 60 people, for instance, so that really every group has more or less an own tutor. And the students, they have fun with it, and as well, I think, the participant as well. So after a while, they have even a personal, relationship with their own tutor. So that is always quite nice to see. And at the end, we have this workshop. And these workshops, at the end of the day, so these workshops really have a new task to solve. So that means we go from Solo 2, from the tutorials, where you have, let's say, a guided solution, to Solo 3 in the afternoon for a specific specific task, but there the solution is not yet depicted or described, so they have to do it really on their own, the participants. And that works actually quite well. So this is a typical program of the ROS Summer School. We do on a yearly and annual base. We have up to 70 participants there. And you see already all this. I don't go in every detail, but you see a lot of these as well, quite complex things like transformations, which is one of my favorite packages, the TF package, hardware sensor, ROS serial, teleoperation, communication, and at the end, a visit to Paris. So the fun part is as well covered. And then even a small introduction to SLAM algorithms, so that they have have a quite good overview in, of course, 2 weeks, which is much too long for an industrial training. That's why Jonathan is around, and he will later on, in a couple of minutes, talk about the way of let's say, transporting this theory or this method to industry. One thing is hardware, so you need robots, and when we designed our own robot, so it's like an RC crawler, and more or less an RC car, we tried to use as much as possible open source technology, so open source hardware, which is not the case, of course, for the TIM LiDAR scanner there from SIG, but most of it, it's just open source stuff, so you get the schematics, you can even build the system on your own when you are at home, and you like to still play around with ROS and with the robots, you can. It's a quite affordable hardware, except of course a laser scanner. And the problem is that we never had, or we don't had an odometry system. So the problem is, if you have no odometry, then it's quite difficult to get, a lot of SLAM algorithms to work. There are only a couple of SLAM algorithms which are working just with laser scanners, so like Hector SLAM and something. Or you use Roboception stuff, which is, so that means we went then later on, we went to a different hardware. Now we are using the TurtleBot 3, which is quite slow. I'm not so convinced about the TurtleBot 3, but the participants, they like the TurtleBot 3 because it's much easier for them to generate good results. So at the end, in the competition, for instance, because you have a differential-driven robot, you don't have to take care of the Ackermann steering or of the Ackermann kinematic of a standard car. So you know Ackermann steering, so you have to back up. Yeah? If you're once wrong at your local planner, you have to go turn and then go around. And so we use the TAP local planner, but to be honest, that's perhaps sometimes a little bit too much for just beginners. So most teams could really finish the competition with the standard TurtleBot 3. What means standard TurtleBot 3? We put our hardware on it, but that was for the participants, of course, quite a nice experience because you get them easily frustrated. So be careful with participants. With all the fun, but if they do not get, let's say, in a certain amount of time, a good result, they get frustrated. And of course, you lose them for the ROS community. So be careful. Here a couple of numbers from the ROS Summer School. So we only counted for this 50, we only counted really the external participants because we have always internal guys here from the university and so on, but we, let's say, come up to more or less always 70. We could even get more because we are running out of seats in the moment, so the inquiries are rising. In 2018 we had 65 and we could even have had more. That is a photo you already saw in Carlos' presentation, but now perhaps, perhaps a small impression what we are doing there. So it starts in the morning with a kind of briefing, so where we talk about what's so essential today and what we're doing and why it's so essential to stay there and make all these nice little seminars and tutorials. We try to activate the participants a lot. So we are asking questions, we are getting in touch with them. If they have questions, for instance, about, from last time they had, of course, you heard about it, deep learning is quite fashionable in the moment, so they ask us about deep learning. And then we made another session about, the basics of deep learning because there were a couple of participants interested in it. And so we have a very interactive way of teaching. So we are not just the teachers in front, but we are really learning from the community as well. At the end, as we said, there's this competition, and you see already here we have still this Ackermann kinematics, so which is a little bit difficult, but they could handle it quite well. So this group made the first prize.
Our challenge was to drive in an arena and find all the AR tags that are placed inside the arena, and we have this rover which was provided by the ROS Summer School, and our approach was to let the rover drive autonomously. So we just push one button, we place the rover in the arena, push one button, and he finds all the AR tags by himself.
Yeah, so and you see that it's more or less the idea is to have like an autonomous pizza delivery service. We have the AR tags everywhere, and then you get a task. Go to this AR tag, go to the Pizzeria Fantastica or something like this, and then you can go driving for it. So it's a quite nice challenge. And as you can see, they're quite fascinated by the way of playing around with robots, and at the end I think you even get a prize sometimes. Ah, okay, that is as well something. So you can even book another 2 days of your V workshop. So we heard about drones as well, and if they are a little bit familiar with ROS, they are allowed to fly our drones. And they don't even, I mean, I think one's crashed, but not many, so that's okay. And we have safety pilots everywhere, and that is, but it's good fun at the end, for the last 2 days. You see they are dancing with the multicopters a little bit. No, it's for calibration, of course. But so that is, let's say, the last step into, yeah, let's say 6D pass planning, if you like to call it like this. And it's always, let's say, quite nice to see then the guys flying around and then have their first script running for an autonomous flight. So that's quite cool. So, but you see as well, sometimes something went wrong. So we burned one turtle bot recently. So this bot is definitely on fire. Yeah, don't do this at home. The thing was, there was a distribution board. The power distribution board was broken in the turtle bot 3, and the LiPo. Yeah, was became thicker and thicker, and then it took fire, and yeah. But you see, nothing happened. So you see, and then I hand over to Jonathan. So these are the evaluation results from the last years. So to the left is better, not to the right. So you see, we improved it quite a lot. Why? For instance, we changed a little the structure. We made much more practical work. So at the beginning, we had more lectures, so theoretical knowledge, but we found out that you really have to have a hands-on program. We have less demanding tasks. At the beginning, we thought as well about, and then, let's say, like a little bit like the urban challenge. Yeah. So, but after 2 weeks, the participants are not able really to solve the urban challenge with stop signs and here and image processing there. And so if they can detect AR tags and drive around a little bit with a differential robot, you're already on a good way. Then we had, it was more like a philosophic, I don't call it a war, but between programming languages, so our informatic guys, they want to have C++. I said, no, we are going with Python because it's not about, let's say, teaching programming skills. It's really about teaching ROS. And Python is a fantastic glue language to get the single modules glued together in ROS. And when you talk about, but they did not the right encapsulation in the class, blah, 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 then you think, but it's not, that's not the point. So that's why we stick to Python, and I think that was definitely the right decision. Yeah, and then you need to really make a big activation of the group so that they exchange their knowledge on their own, and a lot of support. So we really use a lot of tutors. So I hand over to Jonathan for the industry part.
Thank you, Stefan.
Yeah, so.
So is this still working? Yeah. Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Jonathan. I'm from Fraunhofer IPA, as already introduced. Let's see. Okay. It does work. So the part that I'm presenting now is also related to education, but I'm doing the focus on ROS AI academies. So first of all, I would explain what does this term academy mean. And afterwards, I would mainly like to give some impressions of this year. We had a lot of events, so I would like to get you to know what we did and what's upcoming for the next year. So the ROS AI academy is some ROS training, but now we are targeting people from industry, so engineers, and if you look into the chart that I have compiled here, you can see that, so that's the distribution of the participants that we had the last year. You can see that almost half of them are OEMs, then another third are like system integrators, and 16% are from research, and only a small part from university. So our target is really people from the industry to get them used to ROS. And therefore, we do a full week training. So that's the course that we offer. And I would also like to talk briefly about the hardware that you're using. So the participants that are coming to us, they all bring their own laptop, but we have some bootable USB sticks for them. So this means they can plug it into their computer, boot from there, and already have Linux and ROS installed. So it's pretty straightforward to get started. That's quite nice, and you have no interference with their computer, so they don't need to generate a partition on their computer and so on, so it's very easy. And it's also good for us because we are sure that everyone has the same system. So if later on someone has some troubles, it's easier for us to debug that. And last but not least, it's in the end, the participants can take this USB stick with home. So that's also really nice for them. So whenever they feel like they would like to do some ROS programming, they can simply reuse that USB stick. And during the workshop, we do simulation first. So what this means is, first of all, every participant should have the chance to do, for example, the navigation or manipulation by his own on the simulation. And therefore, ROS provides a really good infrastructure with the simulator Gazebo. And here you can simulate all this kinematics or the physics, but you can even simulate camera and laser scan data. So that's very powerful, and we make use of that. And only after that, after the participants have tried the application on the simulation, we move on to the real hardware. And so for the mobile platform, we also, from the beginning, used this TurtleBot 3 platform, which is the common platform in the community. And we really liked it. The reason for that is that it's not so pricey, and it's really compact. So you can even bring it in your hand luggage, which I had to do recently for some academy in London, so it's really useful. And on the other hand, for the robot arms that we are using, here we can benefit from the ROS, that there are so many industrial robot arms available with some ROS interface. And to mention some, we have been using the Denso Universal Robot and Yaskawa and Franke Imica in our trainings so far. So now, briefly about the course agenda. So as I already said, it's like a full week, but the first day is optional. So the first day is dedicated to people from industry that are not used to Linux yet. So, and this is actually what we experience quite a lot. So a lot of people from industry are only used to Windows. So the first day is therefore dedicated for them. And this means we show them live the Linux Ubuntu and how the surface of the OS works, and then go on to the shell basics, how to use a terminal, how to move to another directory, all the typical commands that you often use or need in ROS. And in the end, since we're also doing the whole training week in Python, since we think too that's the easiest way for someone who might not know this language to get started, we have some Python training on the first day as well. Then on the second day, we are doing everything that covers the ROS basics. So we are targeting the file system and the communication. And usually, we always have some theory block where we explain some concepts. And afterwards, we are having these workshops. So where every participant can follow some instructions. In the beginning, it's how to use the terminal, how to start the turtle sim. And in the end, it's going to the real hardware. And then the next 2 days are more dedicated to certain areas. So the day three is targeting manipulation. Here we introduce the robot description and transforms library of ROS. And after that, we are using MoveIt. So as MoveIt says, it's there to move something. And so it's really easy for the participants to use that framework to already move some industrial robot arm. So that's really interesting for them. And the next part is the navigation, and this is split into localization, mapping, and then autonomous navigation. And what that means is that here again, in the end, the participants will be able to use that TurtleBot 3 platform, give it any point on the map that they have generated, and it will go there automatically, avoiding the obstacles. So that's really good goals for them to reach on these days. And last but not least, we have one more day, which we call the Advanced Day. And here we have it split in two different parts. The first one is about state machine based tools. So this is very helpful if they would like to design the application logic. And the second part of that day is called Best Practices from Development to Release. And here we tackle a little bit more advanced topics regarding to packaging, testing, and continuous integration. And therefore, we make use of these workflow that we have designed in ROS Industrial, and we will guide the participants through it step by step. And also, very important, we do some survey by the end. So far, we got some really good feedback, and we also try to use that feedback to improve our academy from every time that we execute it. So here I would like to give some impressions of 2018. We really had a lot of teaching events, and it before I think none, so it really got started with Rosen a lot, and therefore all over our consortium we had some academies, starting from TU Delft, then obviously at our place at Fraunhofer IPA in Stuttgart, then as well at Technalia, and even at our Ross Industrial Partner in Singapore. And so here's on the upper left side, you see our most recent academy that we had in October. And of course, it's always important for us also to do some social dinner to get to know each other. That's what's important in industry. And all right. And beside that, we also had two workshops in this year, all focused to some specific industrial problem. So the first one was in spring. And here we talked about the production line, how to use ROS there. And the topics was how to use the PLC with ROS, or how to use typical industrial communication interfaces. And the second one in fall was more how to reuse an already existing application, but with a new hardware. So here we used some scan and plan application that has originally developed by our partner from ROS Industrial in the US. And we are integrated it with a new robot. And you're welcome to see that tomorrow in the demo sessions. And then I would like to introduce one more concept, which is called training at third parties. And this means we would like to snowball the teaching activities that we are doing. And this means with the goal to spread ROS training in the whole EU, not only to the countries where the consortium is located. And the typical thing is that we find someone who would be interested to offer such an academy, and he would visit one of our academies by himself to get familiar with the content, and especially how the program is structured of the academy. And then he will be doing an own academy at his location, but with some initial support from us, from Rosen. So we would send some instructors to assist him. And the goal of this would be to establish a full self-sufficient academy at that site. And we already got some success stories in this year. So we had some academies going on at FabLab Castelfranco Veneto in Italy. That's the top picture of these two, which has already been early of the year. Then we also have academies at RoboHaus Delft, as mentioned earlier by Carlos. And recently, only last month, we had an ROS Academy by RE.JA at the UCL in London. And so that's the picture below. So with this, we can really snowball that training effort that we are doing to hold Europe to offer for companies that are interested in ROS the possibility to get their people trained. And some outlook.
So there's already this, because Jonathan mentioned the snowball effect, so we exported already the summer school concept to different places. So in Austria, at the management center in Innsbruck, they established a winter school, of course, because then there's snow in Innsbruck. I can imagine that this attracts a lot of people coming around, and a couple of participants running already their own school. And I hope that Jonathan will confess that he attended the summer school as well. Yeah? So, so you see that there is a multiplication already around, and we hope that that will be as well increase the acceptance of ROS in the industry environment, so that people are really well educated and run even their own schools or their own teaching activities. And the rest is
real. Then the rest of this slide is, we would like to say that we have a lot of trainings also for next year. For example, 5 academies happening at Fraunhofer, and we would like to target new targets of material as well. So that might be ROS 2, DDS, or CanOpen. That's what we see is of interest to the industry. And if you are interested into that, you can see the full overview of all upcoming activities on our homepage/events. And the educational project, I do not really need to introduce again. I think Carlos already covered that. But the next cutoff date for that is roughly in 1 month. So thank you all for your attention, and if you have any questions, please feel free.
Thank you, Stefan. Thank you, Jonathan. Are there questions? Yeah, there are some questions.
So just a curiosity. So concerning manipulation, you use the Moovit. But what about the navigation? Which packages do you suggest for the students? Or
so far, what we have been using it would be the most typical package that is in ROS available since long time, which is MoveBase. So I think there are some variation of that already existing, but we are sticking to this most traditional one. Yeah, that's, if you look that up, you should get the whole infrastructure.
So AMCL and then MoveBase, and that is and as I said, in former times we used the Tab Local Planner for this Ackerman kinematics, but now let's go for MoveBase, and then it's okay.
Ah, that's a question for Paul.
I'm curious about as part of the course, do you also cover concepts like responsibility of contributors to the open source repository and maintaining code base and those kinds of concepts? And what's your thoughts about that? Should that be part of a course to thinking about social responsibility of contributing to an open source program?
I mean, from time to time, these questions arise, of course, from the audiences themselves. So the students, of course, they are sometimes quite sensitive, actually, to to ethic questions, for instance. Yeah, so can what's your opinion running it on, I don't know, military or defense? But up to now, so in the Ross Summer School, we didn't do too much in this direction. So of course it's all developing in between the participants themselves. So they are mostly bachelor or master students or PhD candidates. So they have anyway interaction later on, and I think that is always worth discussing. And we are as well now thinking about some, for instance, some quality assurance questions and you know, to broaden a little bit the view. But I think that is more relevant to the industry educational part. So I think you should
about the community. I would say, like, our last day is kind of going that direction. Like, so having this effort of developing a package, how you do the last step to release it and make it open source. And so here we like to motivate our participants to do that, since like that's what is ROS about, that you have all these different packages for everything available. So there we do quite some strong motivation. And
But true. I just remember there was one guy who had his own. He made a talk about the GitHub, how he hosts packages. That's true. So that come, but then this is mostly coming from the student themselves. So they, that now I remember. We try to motivate them to make some lightning talks. So 5 minutes about their current projects, and then sometimes this pops up as well. So that they say, okay, there's a way of, let's say, how you maintain packages or how you host them. Or I mean, of course, we encourage them to support the community. So there's, let's say, half a day dedicated for as well checking wiki pages and saying, okay, look, this is a way of dealing with the community. But it comes more or less from the students themselves, so from the participants themselves. Sorry. Yeah.